I'm delighted to have you all here today for our Michael Baptista lecture. The Michael Baptista lecture is named in honor of the late Michael Baptista, who was a Guyanese-born executive vice president of the Royal Bank and a York alumnus. He received an MBA from the Schulich School of Business. And he, his family and friends endowed this prize and lecture series to honor his spirit and success, his the importance to him of his Guyanese and Caribbean roots, and his outstanding achievements at the Royal Bank, and especially his drive and love of learning. And Sirlak is immensely honored to be the recipient of this endowment and to be able to put on the Baptista lecture, which you're present at here today, and as well as the Baptista essay prizes, which we will also be presenting here today. So before we begin, I would like to thank Sharon Baptista, who is Michael Baptista's widow, for her enormous contributions to Sirlak and to the Baptista Prize over the years. I was telling Sharon that it's actually quite unusual at York to have such a well-funded prize for student work, and so we really feel honored to be able to distribute this prize. And Sharon's support has been really important to Sirlak over the years. The first Baptista lecture was delivered in 1999 by Oscar Arias, who was the former president of Costa Rica. And in general, the lecture seeks to bring prominent speakers from the Latin American and Caribbean region, although Greg is an exception to this rule, here to York. So once again, thank you. I would like to take this occasion to present the Baptista Prize as well. The Baptista Prize gives $500 to an undergraduate essay and a graduate essay on subjects related to Latin America and the Caribbean, or the diasporas, Latin American and Caribbean diasporas. And it seeks to recognize academic excellence in essays that promote greater understanding of the culture and political economy of the regions. We have actually three winners this year, which is great, because we had our graduate competition, we had such excellent essays that we couldn't decide amongst the two finalists, so we have two graduate finalists this year. I am going to just, before we begin, is Nabila here? Or Terine? Okay, great, good. We have two of our three recipients here today. So let me first, Nabila Islam, who is our undergraduate winner, is not here, but I'll tell you a bit about her paper. Her paper was called Subject Making and Resistance in the Amazon, 16th to 20th Century. And the adjudicators noted of her paper that Nabila Islam's essay explores historical representations of the Amazon and its peoples from European and indigenous perspectives. Islam carefully dissects terms and characterizations in both narratives in order to demonstrate how they were connected to and representative of divergent experiences and subjectivities produced through the colonial encounter. And they describe the essay as well-organized, beautifully written, and tightly argued. It could easily be published in a professional journal. So in Nabila's absence, I'd like to applaud her. And I'll invite Sharon up to the stage to present the two graduate winners with their prizes. So the first of our graduate prize winners is Priya Chenke from the anthropology department, I'm pleased to say, as an anthropologist. And we'd like to bring Priya up to the stage. Where are you, Priya? There you are. Priya won the prize for her paper, which was called My Peruvian Museum. The adjudicators described it as a very rich, well-researched, post-colonial and post-modern approach to reframing history and its representation, challenging the great men and great battles view of history not only by identifying but also by unpacking aspects of history and daily life that are often hidden and counter-hegemonic. Another adjudicator noted that it is impressive how even in brief entries, Chenki traces the shifts in meaning and use of objects and events and symbols with attention to nuance, contradiction, and multiple meanings. So congratulations, Priya. And Tyreen, I'd like to invite you up to the stage as well. Tyreen Friday has won the award for her paper on copyright economy, protecting works of mass in Trinidad and Tobago's culture industry. The adjudicators noted that the paper brings cultural studies scholarship into critical conversation with legal discourses about copyright protection, which makes the analysis highly original and insightful. Additionally, the paper makes a compelling argument for decolonizing the region's copyright economy, an argument that has significant implications for understanding the intersection of cultural production and legal protection in the region. So, thank you again. We're very proud, and very proud of our students, and very proud of the sort of richness of scholarship from the undergraduate level and up that the prize allows us to recognize in this forum. So, thank you again. Now, let's move on to the lecture, the Baptista lecture. We are truly honored to welcome Greg Grandin for our Baptista lecture today. His lecture is entitled, Who Ain't a Slave? And I'm forgetting this subtitle this year. Slavery and Freedom, and something like that. Greg Grandin is an extraordinarily accomplished scholar with a number of books to his name, as well as edited books, essays, volumes, and fellowships, and other honors, too numerous to list here. When I first met Greg, which is now a very, very long time ago, he was working on his first book, The Blood of Guatemala, which brought a powerful new voice into scholarship on Guatemalan history, which is too often ignored that indigenous Guatemalans have histories as well as cultures, and that those histories are linked to broader processes in the Americas as a whole. Since then, over a succession of books that many of you will have known or read, The Last Colonial Massacre, Empire's Workshop, Fordlandia, and now The Empire of Necessity, Greg has gifted us both with beautifully crafted and lovingly evoked stories of how different denizens of the Americas have negotiated these broader processes in lives of what I think of as subaltern heroism, and as well as with a sustained critique of American empire and American exceptionalism, which he insists has taken its form and counterpoint to these lives and the other ways of inhabiting the world that they represent. His glowing reviews for all of his books and his nomination for prizes like the National Book Award and the Pulitzer suggest that this message has been heard, despite what you were saying earlier. But Greg is also a public intellectual, and I think this is what brings him, this is what unites him to other people we've had for the Baptista lectures in the past. And I hesitate to invoke this term lightly. It's often invoked and not often necessarily rightly, but in Greg's case, I think it is. His critical commentary for media ranging from Democracy Now! To the New York Times, that's quite a broad span, on U.S. relations with Latin America and on the need to consider Latin American realities outside U.S. agendas for these realities have made him a widely heeded voice of the American left. And for both his scholarship and his public scholarship, his public intellectual scholarship, I am delighted and honored to welcome here today to tell us more about his latest project. Thank you.
Do I talk into this? I don't know if I need to, right? Is this a microphone or is it just a recorder? So I don't really need this, right? Okay. It's quite intimidating to be up here. You can't really see anything. I want to thank Carlota for inviting me. And I mean, I know the lecture series, I usually invite people from Latin America, but I might not be an exception because I like to think of Brooklyn as part of the greater Latin American and Caribbean world. It's really wonderful to be here and to see old friends and friends like Leo and Sam and to be able to come here and talk about my new book, and that's what the topic of the lecture is going to be. This book which just came out a few months ago, The Empire of Necessity, and it's based on its takeoff point is this incredible short novella that Herman Melville wrote in 1855. Called Benito Sereno. And it's nominally set in on a slave ship in the South Pacific, but the story really takes place in the mind of the master class. And not the slave owning master class, because the main character that events turn around, Amasa Delano, wasn't a slave owner. He thought of himself as a modern man. He was from New England, and he thought of himself as part of this kind of new world being born. It was a cheerful modernist, and it really is a remarkable novel. It's unique in form. People know Melville from Moby Dick, which is this sprawling story that takes place over multiple oceans and involves crews of all races, men of all races. Benito Sereno really takes place in one day aboard one ship, and not even that, even more compressed and claustrophobic. It all is told through the worldview of Amasa Delano, the main character. I wouldn't quite call him a protagonist, because I think protagonists have to have some sense or some knowledge or awareness of the world around them, the social world around them, however biased and informed and mediated through their own interests and experiences. But Amasa Delano had no clue. The story unfolds with him in the South Pacific on a sealing expedition, and early one morning he sees his men spot another ship, a distressed Spanish slave ship. It was eerie looking. Melville describes it as almost not coming from around an island in which Delano's ship was, but almost from the depths of the ocean. It was mantled in it was trailing seagrass, and its deck was calcified. Its hull was calcified. Its sails were tattered and worn. And Amasa Delano boards the ship. And events conspire that he spends all day on board the ship by himself. He sends his men back to the island in order to fill the ship's water casks with water and to fetch food. And he becomes increasingly obsessed with the dozens of West African slaves, people he thinks are slaves on board the ship, and the relationship between the man who introduced himself as the ship's captain, Benito Sereno, and Sereno's relationship with his black body servant, his own personal slave, Babo. And about two-thirds into the story, it's revealed that the men that Delano thought were slaves weren't slaves. They had been enslaved, but weeks earlier, they had risen up, seized the ship, and slaughtered most of the Spaniards, including the man taking them, the slave traders taking them to Lima to be sold in Lima's slave market, and demanded to be returned to Senegal, to West Africa. And then this is all revealed at the end of the story, and one of the wonderful things about this very claustrophobic novel is that readers don't have any idea what's coming. Melville is really quite a magician in some ways in his prose and in keeping this revealed. But then it's told in a series of flashbacks that when they ran into Delano's ship, they had two choices. They could have fled or they could have fought, but instead they came up with this plan that they would pretend to still be slaves. And what's wonderful about the story, again, is this feeling of claustrophobia, this feeling of being closed in, of not really knowing what is going on and knowing that there's something strange on board the ship but not being able to identify it, that Melville is able to recreate this worldview of this New England mariner. And the story, which wasn't like many of Melville's stories after Moby Dick, wasn't widely read, but it was written at a very very, very consequential moment in both the author's life and the life of the nation. It was 1855, was a few years after the commercial and critical failure of Moby Dick. Nobody read that novel, and those who did thought it was an indication that Melville had lost his mind or had grown increasingly irrelevant, and a few years before the Civil War. It could be read as a metaphor for the author's own claustrophobia. By that point, he had locked himself into his Berkshire farmhouse and shut himself off from most of the world. And Melville biographers talk about how right after that the story was published, Melville has an emotional, physical breakdown, or a metaphor for antebellum America that's too blind to see what's in front of its own eyes, this looming crisis, the looming civil war, that Melville somehow managed to take the pulse and capture that feeling of existential impasse for the American Republic. It really is just this this wonderful, wonderful story. And so a few years ago, maybe 6 or 7 years ago, I had assigned it a couple of times in a class that I had taught on Latin American US relations. And I had assigned it as a piece of literature, as it captured something about Anglo attitudes, the black legend of Spanish America, and mediated through slavery. And it was just a fun novel to teach. It's just over 100 pages. And I remember preparing one day for class, and I was reading up on secondary literature, and I found up in a footnote of a literary scholar that that it was a true story, that it was all that Melville basically got the story and pretty much retranscribed it in very faithful terms from a chapter of a real person named Amasa Delano, who was a New England sea captain born in Duxbury, Massachusetts. And I remember staring at that footnote, and it was kind of like being told that Ridley Scott's Alien was a true story, because it's kind of the same structure of the story. This, you know, this evil on board, you know, this evil lurking on the ship, but you don't know who or where it is. And then about 2/3 into the story, it explodes, and it's very explosive, and this very dramatic scene, the truth is revealed, which I'll get into a little bit later. And I remember staring at that for a while and trying to make sense of it, because how could this be? I mean, how could these West Africans have pulled off this day-long deception on this experienced New England mariner, who turns out was an ancestor of Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And I started researching it, and I started reading I read the memoir, Amasa Delano's memoir, which was published about 40 years before Melville wrote his story, a little bit less than 40 years, in 1817. And, Melville was famously opaque. Biographers complain that one doesn't really get a sense of what it was that was motivating him. He didn't leave a whole lot of letters or diary entries into the writing process, and that's especially so for Benito Sereno, for this story. There's no explanation of what it was that compelled him to write about this story. But if one reads the historical memoir, if one reads the real event as it was described in chapter 18 of Delano's memoir, one could get a sense of what it was that attracted Melville to the story. As Delano describes events that day, which took place in March in 1804, events kind of have a triangular symmetry of a play. Delano, Benito Sereno, and the name was anglicized a little bit. The real Spanish captain's name was Benito Sereno, with an ñ and two r's, double r. And the black body, the black rebel turned actor pretending to be a slave, Maury. So it has this kind of triangular symmetry, and it also has the psychological and historical depth of a Greek play, a Greek tragedy, or a Greek epic. Homer's Odyssey, for instance, and made me think of Homer's Odyssey, is not about slavery, but it tells of a character, Odysseus, who many scholars think represents the first modern self, because he's able to use cunning, he's able to use his reason and to drive a wedge between his interior life and his interior thoughts and surface reality. And he's able to use his cunning in order to gull the Cyclops and escape from the Cyclops, for instance. I am nobody, Odysseus says, and playing with the subtleties of language in order to escape from that particular predicament. And that's in some ways exactly what these West Africans do, particularly the leaders of this revolt and deception, is that they do to escape Delano. They act as if they were inconsequential slaves. Nobody's hardly worth noticing. And it's that playing around between the kind of interior discipline needed to pull off this deception and being able to manipulate reality, which I think in some ways gets at the heart of slavery's primal deception. Aside from its sheer audacity, I think what's most fascinating about the story is how it exposes this larger falsehood, right, that on which the whole ideological apparatus of slavery, ideological institution of slavery rested. The idea that slaves were loyal and simple-minded people with no independent lives or thoughts, though if they did have an inner life, that that too was the jurisdiction of their masters, that that too was property. And what you saw on the outside was what there was on the inside. So these West Africans, these historical West Africans, which Melville then renders into this wonderful, wonderful novella, were able to play, manipulate the attributes that they were thought to be, loyal and simple-minded and transparent, in order to give the lie to the stereotypes of what they were said not to have, cunning and reason and discipline. And they did so under extreme circumstances. Melville doesn't write about any of this, but by the time they got into the South Pacific, and this is the South Pacific, this is not usually a precinct where we think of studying Atlantic world slavery, right? They had already survived a 2-year ordeal. Many of them were from West Africa, and they were many of them, including the leaders, were Muslim. They managed to track their movements by following the lunar calendar, Islamic calendar, and they were brought into Montevideo. They were driven across the American continent, across the Pampas, then over the Andes at the highest point, then down into the Pacific. So by the time they were in the Pacific, they had already suffered unbelievable amounts of hardship and suffering and death and misery. And yet they were able to call up this remarkable discipline. By the time they ran into Delano's ship, they had already, they were about 50 days into their revolt. And they were out of food, they were out of water, and one could imagine that they would have, the pressure and temptation in order to do whatever they needed to do in order to get food and get water. Two women had died of dehydration, two infant children had died of dehydration, must have been all-powerful and all-consuming, and yet they somehow managed to shed off the trappings of freedom, which was proving ever more elusive every day they drifted in the South Pacific, and managed to play the role of slaves, and in some ways by performing that enslavement, claim some kind of higher freedom, to at least the power and that it took to do that. It was only late in the afternoon, after Delano was completely gulled by what was going on, and deceived by what was going on. He had climbed off of, he had managed, his men brought back water and food, and he was growing increasingly obsessed with why Benito Cedeño, the Spaniard, wasn't really treating him with the respect or the intimacy which he thought he deserved, and why he couldn't get Benito Cedeño alone, why he wouldn't leave his body servant, Mori. But he finally had given up on the whole thing and had climbed over the hull and back into his boat, ready to row back to his own ship, when Mori, who was the primary actor in this deception, he was playing the servant to Benito Cedeño, stepped out of character. Must have been a moment of pride for having pulled this off after 9 hours. And he asked Benito Cedeño, how many men does Delano have on his ship? And when he's told, you know, just a handful, because most of them were sealing on the island, he said, well, good, because we'll take it tonight. We'll just need a handful of us to take that ship, and then we'll have that ship in order to return home. Benito Cedeño realizes that there's not going to be any end to his misery and his ordeal and his captivity. He pitches himself off of the ship and he lands smack in the middle of Delano's boat. And it's only at that moment that Delano kind of realizes the reality of the situation. And then he marshals his men on his ship to retake the slave ship, retake the ship, the rebel ship, and pacify it, and put down the rebellion and re-enslave the rebels, which I'll come back to in a little while. It's also, what's remarkable about the story in some ways is that it took place at almost exactly the same time that the German philosopher Hegel was composing the master-slave analogy, the metaphor that some scholars of slavery has taken as the master metaphor of slavery and freedom, right? The metaphor of the master and the slave, the master who imagines himself to be omnipotent over the slave, and then gradually comes to realize his own dependency, and it's in that kind of dialectic of interdependency that human consciousness evolves, according to Hegel. In some ways, that's what's going on in this ship in the South Pacific. In some ways, these South Pacific West Africans are enacting it, except that it's not just a dialectic. There's a third person. Amasa Delano is witness to the dialectic, but he's too dense to realize what it is that he's seeing. And there's evidence that Melville had read Hegel, so who knows exactly what it, maybe this kind of resonated. But in any case, in the book, The Empire of Necessity, I tell two stories. I try to track two movements. One is the movement of the West Africans out of West Africa, across the Atlantic and into the Americas, and what I just mentioned earlier. And then the other is the movement of Amasa Delano out of New England and into the South Pacific. And it's a kind of intersection of two different forms of exploitation and violence, which I'll come back to later, but one obviously is human slavery and the race terror that emerges from it. And the other is the violence of sealing and one of the first, sealing being one of the first experiences of resource extraction of the United States beyond its borders. So Amasa Delano is a sealer. And I think the intersection of these two institutions in a very dramatic way says something about both, which I'll come back to. The event took place in 1800. The rebellion on the ship, the Spanish ship, was called the Trial. Took place in 1804 and the Deception in early 1805, and it was a very consequential moment in what historians call the Age of Liberty. It was 1804 was the year that Haiti declared independence. After a long, protracted insurgency and fending off France's attempts to reimpose slavery and reimpose colonialism. A generation after the U.S. Revolution, a generation before the Spanish-American Revolution, at the height of what in Spanish America was the unleashing of the slave trade, what Spanish Americans, what Spain and Spanish merchants called in very frank terms, without mincing any words, free trade in blacks. When we think of slavery, at least in the United States, it tends to focus on the period before the decades before the Civil War, the antebellum period, when slavery explodes with the invention of the cotton gin, the move into the Mississippi bottomlands, into Louisiana, into Texas, the demand for cotton, demand for sugar. And what this story allows is a kind of broadening of that, and thinking about that as the last stage in a larger Pan-American or Trans-American explosion or extension or expansion of slavery, linked to free market, linked to the market revolution, to the Atlantic market revolution. Slavery obviously existed in the Americas since the 1500s, but theoretically, at least, it was regulated under a system of mercantilism. But starting in the 1770s, with each kind of burst of revolutionary ardor, the American Revolution, the French Revolution, the execution of Louis XIV, the Haitian Revolution, Spain responded by deregulating the slave system, by granting Spanish merchants in the Americas more and more freedom. To buy and sell human beings, where previously only a handful of ports were entry points for slaves and for the importation of enslaved Africans, and only a handful of very select companies or countries had the monopoly rights to bring in slaves, and only a handful of very well-connected merchants participated in the slave trade. By 1804, slavery was a free-for-all. Montevideo was one of the ports in which slavery was liberalized, deregulated, privatized, tariffs were lowered, taxes were lowered. More West Africans came in 1804 when this group of West Africans came in to Montevideo than in any year previously. one of the things that's interesting about this story is that one group of these West Africans who came into Montevideo, they came in different consignments and different ships, had actually been on their way to the Caribbean on a Liverpool slaver when it was intercepted by a French Jacobin pirate, it was an ardent defender of the French Revolution, loyal to Napoleon, and he presided over a multi-hued crew of men of all nations from Africa, from Haiti, from Spanish America, from the Mediterranean, and in some ways you would think of them as kind of holding to this image we have of pirates and privateers as proto-anarchists sailing the ever free sea, enthralled to no man or to no nation. But in the case of this ship and other French privateers, they were the vanguards of Spanish American merchant capitalism. This particular ship had contractual relations with Montevidean and Buenos Aires merchants, in which they were to seize British goods and bring them into the Rio de la Plata, into Montevideo and Buenos Aires. And by far the most profitable cargo was slaves. Were enslaved Africans, and one group was on a Liverpool slaver, as I mentioned, and it was intercepted and then brought into Montevideo. So what I try to do in the book was, let me just say that one of the fascinating things about this story is tracking this privateer, this French privateer. It was actually captained by a Frenchman who had lost his arm. So there's actually a one-armed French pirate that starts the story, which I never realized how much I wanted to start a book with a one-armed French pirate until I actually did. And the men in his crew had trouble saying his name, because his name was, I can't pronounce it because I don't speak French, but it was Francisco Hipolito Morday, no sé qué. And so the men on his crew, particularly the Spaniards, called him Capitán Manco, because he only had one arm, so Manco being a Spanish, crippled or one arm. And Morday was upset not by the nickname, but by the rank. He preferred to go by the name Citizen Manco, because he was a French privateer. So I think it somehow captures it was really a floating contradiction of the age of revolution and the age of liberty was also the age of slavery. Edmund Morgan, a historian writing in the 1970s, looking at colonial Virginia, came up with that famous phrase, the paradox of American slavery and American freedom, showing the ways in very real and material and ideological ways and political, how American freedom was dependent on and defined by slavery. So I try to take that paradox and think about it on a larger American level. The ways in which ideas of freedom and ideas of in a distinction and autonomy and preference and interests, all of the things that we think about associated with republicanism and liberalism, were formed very much rooted in the slave system and the expansion of this the centrality of slavery in the expansion of the market revolution in the Americas, and particularly in South America. With the expansion of what I mentioned, Spaniards called free trade in blacks. It seems like an abstraction to say that the age of freedom was also the age of slavery. But one statistic that I was blown away by was historians estimate that about 12.5 million Africans were taken out of Africa and brought to the Americas. They have documentation on ships and about over 10 million of that estimated 12.5, if not higher. More than half came in after July 4th, 1776. So you get a real sense of the ways in which the age of slavery was also the age of freedom. In Spanish America, one of the things that the book tries to do is there's an implicit comparison with the plantation system of slavery in North America, which develops, and a much more diverse labor system involved in coerced enslaved Africans in South America, and African Americans in South America. The way slaves served every part of that market revolution. They were commodities, they were capital, they were credit, they were collateral, they were status symbols for a rising gentry and a rising bourgeoisie and a rising merchant class. They served as adornments for a declining aristocracy that was latching on to something solid in this world of flux that was being revolutionized by market capitalism. They became objects of nostalgia. And by tracking this movement across the Americas, I think I was trying to get a panorama snapshot of that and think about the ways slavery was central to the age of freedom and the age of liberty. So the other story is Amasa Delano. In Melville's hand, Melville renders him as the first in a long line of American idiots abroad, U.S. innocents abroad. That, you know, I know we're in Canada, but I can't help but use the word American. But American. You know, this kind of think of Graham Greene's The Quiet American, right? That go about in the world unable to connect the consequences of the disaster that their actions have provoked. And it's really this remarkable, remarkable portrait and fictionalization of Amasa Delano, and powerful in its own right, and subtle in the way that it's rendered. He's rendered into this one-dimensional prototype of that kind of avatar of American innocence. It's subtle and deep and profound in all sorts of ways. But the real Amasa Delano, in some ways, I think, tells a different story of the centrality of. It tells a different story about American expansion and America and Americans going abroad. Delano was, in many ways, a new man of the American Revolution. He was born just a few years. He was born in the last year of the Seven-Year War, a few years before the American Revolution. He came of age during the American Revolution. The American Revolution. He was born in Duxbury, which is a coastal town in Massachusetts, a shipbuilding town, a fishing town, that really was a hotbed of natural law liberalism, and an early town to move away from Calvinist gloom and embrace a much more optimistic version of human nature. The idea that human beings were perfectible, that there was no predestination, that individuals, men, could harness their discipline, their virtue, and their reason to tame their passions and their appetites and their vices and govern themselves. And that belief being the kind of foundation of a Republican theory of governance. And Duxbury really was a paradigm of that, a hotbed of that. A number of ministers that would go on to become early Unitarians came out of Duxbury. And Amasa Delano comes from a small craftsman's family, a fishing family, a shipbuilding family, a family that did okay, but didn't grow very wealthy as Duxbury after the years of the American Revolution began to stratify economically, and some people in town grew increasingly rich. He came from a family that wasn't poor, that did well in shipbuilding and in fishing. But at a moment where going abroad was in some ways the way in which, in an increasingly stratified local economy, going abroad was the only way he could balance virtue and ambition, right? I mean, if he stayed within Duxbury in a town that was growing economically stratified with more and more poor people, more and more concentrated wealth, you would either have to confront that wealth and give in to envy and give in to ambition and unleash the kind of passions that you would see later with the French Revolution. And Amasa Delano, in his memoir, explicitly would draw comparisons between the American Revolution and the French Revolution. Or you could go abroad, and going abroad was a way to be both ambitious and be virtuous at the same time, as a way of balancing that. And there's almost a pathos in Delano's memoir. Melville was attracted, I think, to that chapter 18 where he recounted his where he recounted his experiences on board the, being duped on board the Spanish, cargo ship that was carrying these West Africans. But the whole memoir is really just this remarkable, Delano wrote it, he said, to contribute to the world's stock of knowledge, kind of like an encyclopedia. But as he recounts his adventures, it's almost a testament to the impossibility of knowledge or the impossibility of doing anything with that knowledge once you have it. One thing, it's a parade and a procession of fiascos and disasters and mortifications, a word that repeatedly appears in his memoir. He's mostly a failure at everything. He's catapulted into the American Revolution catapults him into world history. And he witnesses some of the events that we think of as creating the modern world. He's in South Africa at the beginnings of racial segregation. He's in India at the beginning of British colonialism. He experiences the French Revolution in the Indian Ocean and Ile-de-France. He's in the Galapagos a few decades before Darwin is. He witnesses the Battle of Saratoga. But he can't quite make sense, or he can't quite get a handle on it. The promise, I think, of the American Revolution is always out, just out of his grasp. The one exception is when he becomes a sealer. And sealing was this remarkable industry that in many ways was the first experience of the United States with boom and bust resource extraction outside of its borders. We think of whaling largely because of Melville's wonderful description of it in Moby Dick. Sealing was something else entirely. It took place, the boom was a few years in the 1790s, and the bust came with remarkable quickness in the early 1800s. Whaling took place on a watery commons, open to all. Sealing took place, and it invokes, and in Melville's hands, whaling is a kind of industry that is brutal and violent and bloody, but it's also sublime in the sense that it integrates races together, it integrates men together in working and extracting and boiling the rendering the whale oil, rendering the whale fat into oil. There's some loving descriptions of that in Moby Dick. Sealing was something else entirely. If whaling suggested proto-industrialization and the solidarity that could take place within industrialization, sealing was settler colonialism. It happened on land. It took no skill to kill the seals. It often resulted in bloody and pitched battles among sealing crews, leaving these islands completely wasted and denuded of seals. And Amasa Delano was there at the beginning, and he was there at the end. He was there for the boom, and he was there at the bust. His first sealing expedition was in the 1790s, And there were hundreds of thousands of seals on beach after beach, rookery after rookery, on beach after beach, on island after island, these islands off of Chile in the South Pacific. Delano himself took hundreds of thousands of seals and brought them to Canton and traded them for porcelain and for spice and for tea and did quite well in his first sealing voyage. This was one of the one moment of success that he has in his memoir. By the time of his second voyage, the seals were gone. First he hears that the seals have dis- what happened was that so many seals skins were coming into Canton that the market became glutted, and seal skins were rotting on the dock in the rain. They couldn't fit into the warehouses, and the price began to collapse. And that led sealers to accelerate the killing. It was almost as all or nothing a system of labor relations and environmental exploitation as one could imagine. As profits dried up, fights and mutinies and fraud between officers and crew became increasingly commonplace. It was almost as all or nothing system of labor relations as you could imagine before any given ship was able to fill its hold with seals. They were the captains and officers were completely dependent on the SEAL crews that they left on board on shore on these islands, and the time that they left them on these islands increased as the SEAL herds disappeared, as the rookeries disappeared, and then as soon as the hold was full, the crews and the officers didn't need the men, and they often abandoned them on the Spanish Main or on these islands or in Canton without giving them their share. It increased tensions among sealing ships and expeditions and within the ships themselves. And if Amasa Delano was there for the boom, he was there for the bust. So in 1803, he leaves Boston and he first heads to Tasmania, to Australia, because he hears that the seals are few in on the islands off of Chile. But there are no seals in Tasmania, in the Bass Straits. He loses his men. His men jump ship because there's no money to be made. He's forced to take on a crew of escaped convicts from Hobart, the British penal colony, in a settlement in Tasmania. He heads back. He decides to head back towards Chile in order to see if there's any seals there. His men start to grouse. They start to conspire. He resorts to more and more physical punishment in order to maintain authority until he intersects with the trial. The Spanish cargo ship carrying the slaves, captained by Benito Cedeño. And what that experience, once the deception is revealed, and once he mobilizes his men, he marshals his men to put down the slave revolt with unbelievable brutality. They use the sealing lances, that they use to skin the seals in order to disembowel some of the rebels that refused to surrender on board the ship. And it was an unbelievably bloody scene. And in so doing, he even though he himself is opposed to slavery, he's able to reestablish his authority over his men. And I think that this is a moment, of a very, very visceral moment, visceral in a literal sense, in the terms of the viscera that spilled out on board the deck of the trial, in which race terror and ecological violence kind of intersect. And you see the way racism emerges out of this context of ecological exhaustion and this race terror. You know, Amasa Delano is an interesting, both the historical Amasa Delano and the fictional Amasa Delano are interesting to think about as juxtaposed to the other more famous creation of Melville, Ahab. Ahab is often thought about as a symbol, an icon of unhinged American power. Oliver Stone has a great line in Platoon where he equates the sergeant who massacres an innocent Vietnamese village with Ahab. Edward Said famously compared George Bush's pursuit of Saddam Hussein, obsession with Saddam Hussein, to Ahab. But I think that thinking about Ahab as an emblem of U.S. power misses the mark in some ways, and in some ways is too easy an analogy. Ahab is a rebel, he's an exception. He hunts his white whale with a monomania that goes against all economic rationality. There's a great scene in Moby Dick where Starbuck says, this obsession with the white whale is detrimental to the owners of the Pequod. And Ahab says, owners, what care Ahab? You know, let them stand on a Nantucket beach and howl into the wind. I don't care. He's a rebel. He's often held up not just as a symbol of American power, but as a symbol of kind of totalitarian 20th century power, a certain kind of mesmeratic, charismatic power that which was able to bind his men or pull his men into his emotional thrall through his charisma. And so he becomes a symbol of totalitarianism, be it of the left or the right. But again, I think that misses the mark. I think Amasa Delano in some ways is a much more useful and much more complicated symbol of American expansion and American empire. He's not the exception, he's the rule. He is faithful to the laws of capital, and throughout his book he talks about the need to stay loyal and faithful to institutions, whether they're his financial backers or his insurers. Even though he's a opposed to slavery. He winds up, he gets caught up in the laws of supply and demand. He gets caught up in this ecological vortex, this, you know, of diminishing natural resources. And he rallies his men, not in pursuit of a metaphysical white whale, but in pursuit of black rebels. And I think that this is, it lends itself to a very graphic and explosive moment in which ecological violence and race violence come together, and in fact where racism itself is formed in some ways. One of the things that Melville changes, Melville largely stays faithful to Amasa Delano's account from chapter 18. He fills it with that atmospherics and tells it from Amasa Delano's point of view, which is Melville's the value added part of Melville. But then at the end he changes it a bit. He has after the slave rebellion is put down and after the events, the reality of the situation is revealed to readers and the slave revolt is put down and some of the West Africans are executed. He ends the story with Amasa Delano consoling a broken and shattered Benito Sereno, not Sereno, the literary character, in a monastery in Peru, and he tries to get Benito Sereno to cheer up, and it's this incredible moment where he says, "Look at the blue sky, and look at the trade winds that caress our cheek, and look at the sea, like they've moved on. Why can't you move on?" And Benito Sereno says, "Because they're not human, because they have no memory." And it's this remarkable moment for two reasons. One, I think it captures something about, basically, I think it's Melville's critique of the blindness of American empire, of U.S. empire, and the inability to witness to the dialectic, but not being able to understand the dialectic. But what's also interesting about it is that that's not what happened in real life. In the actual event, Delano spends about 8 months trying to get half of the value of the surviving slaves. A number of the slaves are brought back to Talcahuano, a port city in southern Chile, and then to Concepcion, where they're put on trial and they're executed. But about 50 of them are sent on to Lima, where they're sold in the Lima market. And Delano engages in this dogged pursuit of the historical Benito Sereno. There's no counseling or comforting. They have this falling out, and it's this remarkable mercantile or mercenary pursuit. And again, it was driven by economic necessity, the need to pay the men on his ship in order to keep their loyalty, and this. He winds up getting some of the money, but not as much as he had hoped. And he goes back. He winds up back in the United States, and the rest of his life is largely a bust. He goes and he comes back to a changed America, changed New England, and he falls into debt. He's in debtor's prison, and he dies in 1823, about the year that it's an interesting year. It's the year of the Monroe Doctrine. It's the year most of the Americas have declared themselves Republican, and he passes away. I think maybe I could talk a little bit more about Delano, but I think maybe what I'll do is just wrap up by talking a little bit about what I meant by the title, The Empire of Necessity. Melville uses, it's a phrase from Melville, The Empire of Necessity. Melville has another a fascinating short story called The Bell Tower that he publishes around the time of Benito Sereno. And he has an epigraph into that story that says that seeking to conquer a larger liberty, man but extends the empire of necessity. What's great about it is that he attributes it to an anonymous author, an unpublished manuscript in the author's possession, but many Melvillians think that he actually just made it up and he just wrote it himself and then attributed it to this unpublished manuscript, so kind of creating this authority and citing it. In any case, Melville believed in emancipation. He believed in universal freedom. But he refused an idea of freedom that defined itself as the opposite of slavery. As he grew older, he increasingly criticized what he described as a vile liberty that he felt that was taking hold in the United States. He thought that most people lived somewhere between the two poles of liberty and freedom that define the political rhetoric of anti-Jacksonian American and antebellum America. And I think that that was what he was getting at with the phrase of empire of necessity, seeking to conquer a larger liberty, man but extends the empire of necessity. To my mind, the idea conveys forward motion. It hints that it's not the paradox of freedom and slavery that's the problem, but the denial of the paradox, right? The inability to see the paradox, again, like Amasa Delano on board the trial, watching the Spaniard and the West African and not being able to see what was what. United States' ceaseless bids to escape the paradox, to slip out of the shackles of history, only serve to deepen old entanglements and create new necessities. The way, for example, the opening of the West, which was held up as a solution to the crisis of slavery in the East, wound up accelerating the crisis and accelerating the rest of war. The way the rise of free trade promised and still promises that if men were set free to pursue their interests, an ever more harmonious world would result. And in the United States today, I think that we see the residue of this ideal that that Melville was criticizing, a purer or more perverse notion of freedom has come to hold sway, at least among some, based not just on the fantasy of free trade, but and small government, but on a more primal animus. An individual supremacy that not only denies the necessities that bind people together, but resents any reminder of those necessities. Herman Melville spent most of his whole life, whole writing career, considering the problem of freedom and slavery, but he often did so elliptically, intent it seemed on disentangling the experience from the particularities of skin color, of geography, of economics. He rarely wrote about human bondage as an actual social institution, a historical institution with victims and victimizers, but rather as an existential or a philosophical condition common to all. Who ain't a slave is a line from Moby Dick, and the answer to that is nobody, but the answer, he offers that in a kind of joyous way, than an acceptance of who ain't a slave. Acceptance of one's bondage, you know, that we're all fast fish, we're all loose fish at the same time, we're all entangled in whale lines, is an acceptance of the human condition. Benito Sereno is an exception, where he actually does talk about slavery as a real institution. But even here, I think by forcing the reader to adopt the perspective of Amasa Delano, Melville is concerned less with exposing specific social horrors than with revealing, as I mentioned earlier, slavery's foundational deception. Not just the fantasy that some men were natural slaves, but the others were absolutely free. There's a sense reading the story that Melville knew or he feared that the fantasy wouldn't end, that after abolition, if abolition ever came, it would adapt itself to new circumstances, becoming ever more elusive and ever more entrenched in human affairs. And I think that it's this awareness and its dread that makes Benito Sereno so enduring a story. There's a sense that Melville identified in Amasa Delano the emergence of a new kind of racism, a racism that wasn't based on religious or philosophical doctrine, but on the psychic need to divine one's absolute freedom in opposition to another's absolute slavishness. This racism that was born in chattel slavery but didn't die with chattel slavery. It involved today's cult of individual supremacy that I think is very much present in US political culture and political discourse, that try as it might, can't shake off its white supremacist roots. So we have politicians in the United States like Rand Paul, who could say with a straight face that belief in the ideal of healthcare, or the right to health, is like believing in the right to enslave other people. And I think it's crazy on the face of it, but I think that there's a logic to those kind of equations, that when you pull them out of the soil, the strata that they're embedded in, and you see the roots, I think they can't escape this history of chattel slavery, this free trade in blacks, which kind of imprinted itself in American political culture in different degrees. In some ways, there's an implicit comparison with Latin America, which I don't make explicitly and overtly at the end, but different ways in which they want the centrality of slavery as an institution in defining one's recognition of the empire of necessity. And I think it's reflected in ongoing endurance of social democracy and social democratic ideals in Latin America, and the kind of individual democracy that is supreme in the United States. I could talk more, but I have no idea how long I've gone on for. So maybe I'll just end there, and maybe we could bring up the lights, and I can answer questions if there are any questions. Thank you so much.
So do you want to, I can help pick people out of the audience.
Sure, you can pick people.
Would anyone have any questions?
They said that you have to bring the microphone because.
Oh, okay. Where is there? Okay. Anyone have any questions? Thoughts up.
Thank you for an excellent talk. There's a series of different kind of questions that are lurking that I might have trouble articulating. So I'll start with the last one, and then afterwards I can ask the others. And that has to do with the final analogy you made with Latin America and the kind of reverse, if I'm following the extension of the argument, the reverse form in which the relationship with the institution of slavery plays itself out in social democracy. So I just kind of wanted to hear the end of that argument, and then I'll ask the other questions.
Okay. Oh, yes.
Oh. Well, I think that I think it transcends slavery. I think that it has to do with the way the colonial Spanish state dealt with difference. I think right from its inception, it was a colonial state that was both universal in its conception and giving rise to many of the premises of international law and universal law that we think of, but it administered itself, and it was administratively set up to administer difference, and I think that I think that difference, whether it be slavery or whether it be the enslavement of Native Americans and the mobilization of Native Americans to extract value in all sorts of different ways, or whether it be slavery in the slave zones of Latin America, was much more central to the colonial project. And I think that the Republicans who inherited that, who believed that they were transcending it, had to deal with the problem of race and difference in a much more direct way. I think the colonial experience in the America was about denial of difference and the ideological fiction of pushing difference off to the side, even as that was not actually the case. And I think that gave rise to two very distinct forms of republicanism. One, a republicanism that emphasizes the creation of a virtuous state, that sees the state as being a much more active role in creating a virtuous society, that virtue wasn't going to emerge magically out of the unleashing of individual interests, and a republicanism that imagined a state as a defender of individual, as the unleashing of individual interests, and that's where virtue arises. And I think that's the general comparison where slavery fits in within that. I think it deserves more attention, which I didn't do in the book, and I don't really have an answer. I also think it's interesting. I think the role of slavery in relationship, when the respective wars of independence come in relationship to slavery. So the fact that slavery expands after the American Revolution in the United States, and that explosion of free trade slavery takes place after. I think there's a way in which what we would think of as social rights and economic rights could be disentangled from political rights, whereas in Spanish America, I think that disentanglement wasn't possible because the market revolution and the explosion of slavery took place before the movement for independence. And even though it was graduated and deferred in all sorts of ways in different countries, and you know, abolition didn't come about with independence in Spanish America, at the same time simultaneously, I think that there was much more of a sense that independence involved abolition even if it took, even if it, in actuality it took longer to get where I think that would be another point of comparison for the emergence of these two distinct political cultures.
Do you
want to
go on, or should we
have another question?
Thank you so much. So interesting. And I have about 1,000 questions as well that I'd love to ask. But I wanted to just pick up on something that you mentioned at in sort of the first part of your discussion, where you brought up the idea, I mean, throughout you've talked about freedom and notions of freedom and sort of the complicated ways that differently positioned people thought about freedom. So whether they were in Europe or already in colonized parts of the world. But then you specifically spoke to the ways in which the African slaves on the boat performed freedom. And I thought that was a really interesting notion, and I wondered if you could expand on that.
Okay. So, one of the things involved in recounting and in researching the story that I didn't have time to go into much was the role of Islam in shaping the perception. And let me just premise this by saying that there isn't a lot of documentation. The documentation is all official documentation, right? You know, imputing to the West Africans. So trying to get at the experience of what the West Africans were thinking or doing is all a matter of speculation and supposition. But the Spaniards did identify them as Muslim and as literate Muslim. And I thought that was interesting in a number of different ways. One, the revolt happened on the holiest day of Ramadan, the night of power. They rose up on, and it was also the day, interestingly enough, that that the largest urban slave uprising in the America in Bahia in 1835, which historians have documented was largely an Islamic uprising, also took place on the night of power. So it's just an interesting similarity, the importance. It's the day in Islam, in theology, where in the Quran, where the angel Gabriel reveals the first verses of the Quran. And it's a prophetic day, and it's a day that one could imagine as kind of trying to reconcile human action and will with predestination and God intervening in history. So it must have been it was a very powerful day within the Islamic character, and the fact that that 2 years after the beginning of their ordeal, they were able to, you know, document that, you know, start the rebellion on the night of power or the night of destiny. Is fairly remarkable, but one of the things that the Spanish documents often mentioned a number of times was that they were literate. That at least Mori and Babo and the leaders of the rebellion and the leaders of the deception were able to read and write in their own language. So much so that they even before they ran into Masa Delano, they forced Benito Cedeño to sign a contract saying that that if he returned them to West Africa, they would let him leave with his ship. So they were well versed in maritime law and contractual law, which is interesting, which also might have been related to the fact that they were Muslim. A lot of this literature on slavery emphasizes the oral traditions of African slaves and the trickster traditions, and that would be one way to approach this, right? The trickster, the being able to kind of perform and deceive and dupe this New Englander. But I thought it would be more interesting to try to think about the deception in terms of Islam and in terms of what it meant and what the relationship is between freedom and slavery. And if Amasa Delano represented a certain kind of strong individualistic tradition within Christianity that began to emphasize the possibility of human autonomy and independence and self-governance, and which lays the groundwork for abolitionist Christian abolitionist movements later. Islam has a much more Melvillian understanding of the relationship of freedom to slavery. And there's a great Sufi quotation from a theologian that says that runs something like the true meaning of freedom is the perfection of slavery. And so if Babo and Maury had some experience, and they came from a place, not only were they Muslim, they came from West Africa, which had its own traditions of slavery and enslavement. They might have been slaves in West Africa, they might have been slaveholders in West Africa. So Islam is a religion that has a deep engagement with the problem of slavery and the problem of freedom in different ways. And its resolution, as I mentioned, tends to be more Melvillian in its understanding of not oppositional, but much more relational. And so in some ways, that's what Babo, Maury, and the West of the West Africans did. They achieved freedom by perfecting slavery, by performing slavery. And again, in the larger context of what we do know is that they were starving and they were desperate. There was no more food left. They were through a number of storms. Benito Cedeño was stalling. He was sailing up and down the Chilean coast, trying to do everything he could to avoid rounding the Cape. And so that freedom, which they had risen up. And seized on the holiest day of the Islamic calendar, was proving ever more fragile, ever more illusory, as with every day they would drift in the Pacific. So in some ways, what their performance was the enactment of this understanding of the relationship of freedom is the perfection of slavery. You know, this is all, again, speculation, but I was trying to think through it in ways that, imagining the importance of this kind of literate theological tradition of West African Islam on their actions, rather than thinking about how oftentimes historians of slavery tend to emphasize the rural orality and the folk tales that are passed around the campfires of the tricksters and thinking about that. I think that would have been an easier way to think about what they were doing, but I was trying to think about it in situated in terms of Islam.
And we'll do you and then you. Go ahead.
Oh, okay, thank you. You were talking about how this novella of Melville's is kind of an exception, right? That he didn't write so explicitly about political things like this, and even the line that empire to necessity comes from, he sort of distanced himself from it without, not necessarily tripping, if it was him, he distanced himself from it.
Right.
So do you think he's sort of maybe guilty too in a way of...
Melville had a complicated relationship, yeah. You know, I mean, he was paralyzed by the problem of slavery. You know, a lot of people of his generation, including Nathaniel Hawthorne and his father-in-law, Lemuel Shaw, they were Democrats and they believed in that slavery should end, but they believed more firmly in the preservation of the Union. And Melville was I think paralyzed by what he thought was the impasse of antebellum America, that you could fight to end slavery and possibly destroy the Union, or you could leave slavery in place and admit that freedom for some required the enslavement of others. And I think that he saw that as a much more deeper impasse. Where others of his generation, like Nathaniel Hawthorne and a lot of these Boston politicians like Daniel Webster and all of these people, had worked out all sorts of compromises with the South in order to keep them within the Union, he never reconciled himself to that impasse. The people around him would too easily reconcile themselves to that impasse. It's complicated. What's complicated is that people don't actually really know much about Melville and his political position, so there's a lot of projecting onto his writings, which are rich. Bartleby the Scribner's critique of commodification of social relations. Benito Cereno is obviously, Moby Dick could be read in any sorts of way, but there's not a lot. He doesn't, in his letters, he doesn't reveal himself as a political man. And so a lot of left Melvillians who want to say that he was a critic of empire and American individualism and slavery. And then there are right Melvillians who say, well, he might have been interested in those things and he could be a cutting critic of hypocrisy, but he really was concerned about more existential things and more cosmic matters. And what I find fascinating is there's ways in which I think that Melville's metaphysics were ultimately about slavery. I mean, he was concerned with what meaning an individual had in relationship to larger structures of authority. What was the meaning of individuality in a world that was rendered in a cosmos that was being disenchanted by Darwin? He was concerned with metaphysics, with trying to grasp the reality behind the pasteboard mask of a world that seemed to be ever more elusive in which the mask isn't hiding reality, but the mask is reality. And all of those things, I think, are ultimately about slavery. I think Melville's metaphysics are ultimately about slavery and capitalism, and whether he himself knew that it was. And so here's an example. This is a little bit of a, so what I try to do in the book is tell the story with an integrity that it deserves, which is in 1805, which is about the age of revolution, and then think about what Melville 50 years later was saw in the story particular to the US in the 1850s. That's two very different things. What's interesting about it is, there's all sorts of ways in which slavery keeps revealing itself as being more central to Melville's outlook. There is one passage in this novel in 1849 that he publishes, Redburn, in which he stumbles across in Liverpool, the character representing Melville, stumbles in Liverpool on a statue of Lord Nelson, Horatio Nelson, who died in the Battle of Trafalgar in the early 1800s. And most statues to Trafalgar to Nelson are very simple affairs. In London, there's him in a full dress uniform aboard this column. But in Liverpool, it's this grotesque statue of a naked Lord Nelson falling back into death's arms with a skeleton reaching up to grab his heart, and around the base are these four prisoners of war in shackles, and they're meant to represent Spanish and French prisoners. But then Melville in Redburn says, he goes on this extended riff about how he could never look at those prisoners of war without thinking of African slaves in the marketplace. And then from there he goes on to the wealth that the wrongs of Africa created, and how it built the city of Liverpool, and how it built the Carolinas and Virginia. And it's this incredible three paragraphs, it's almost stream of consciousness in which it's not so much the ideas that he's expressing are important, which they are, that the wealth of slavery create the prosperity of the West, but it's almost a talking cure, the way in which he's, it's one thing after another, one association after another is reminding him of slavery. What's fascinating about that is, so he writes that in 1849, about 6 years before he writes Benito Cedeño. That statue was put up in the 1810s, and it was raised primarily with, there were a number of different Liverpool slavers and merchants who put up that statue, but John Bolton, the merchant who owned the Liverpool slaver that was intercepted by that citizen Manco, was the person who raised that statue. So in other words, the statue that first prompted Melville to think about slavery in a real historical and political way was raised by one of the men responsible for bringing the West Africans, at least out of West Africa, into the Americas, that would later inspire Melville to write his masterpiece, Benito Cedeño. So it's this ways in which slavery is just embedded in his thoughts, that it's inescapable. And I think it says a lot of different things.
Dan, do you have people want to raise their hand?
Thank you. This just so much to think about in everything that you've said. But maybe two things, and I, if there is a question in this, I'm struck by the imagery, you know, at the beginning with this ship looking as though it's actually appearing out of the ocean, and then your last reference a few seconds ago to the sense in which Melville is sort of obsessed with the issue of slavery, and he chooses to think about it and write about it in the context of the sea, and the slavery, other than the example that you've given, the slavery that he's reflecting about is really a slavery that takes place on land. Of course, the ship plays an important part in the journeys. And so the context for the story that you're telling is the sea. I wonder if there's a way in which you could sort of make the context also part of the thinking. I'm curious about the extent to which the sea might be something that Melville is not just thinking on, but is actually thinking with. So there's you talked about the elusiveness, for example, of this thing called freedom. And you think of the sea as, you know, symbolizing something free and floating, but also constraining at the same time, the running out of food.
Yeah.
So I'm curious about making the possibility for making the backdrop, the context, more explicit as a thought process.
Yeah. Well, I mean, in a more prosaic way, a lot of Melville, political theorists like Melville, because on these ships represent political society and the hierarchy of political society and all sorts of ways in which you can imagine how authority is constituted, right? Through the family, through contractual relations, through hierarchy. So political theorists like Melville, because almost every one of his sea novels say something about Billy Budd and Benito Cedeño and obviously Moby Dick, but other ones as well. I have another kind of story which speaks to the sea, maybe not exactly in the way that you're suggesting, which I'm gonna need to think about. But in Moby Dick, the most sympathetic character on that ship is Pip, the little black cabin boy, and you don't know whether he's there as an indentured servant or a slave, and you don't even know if he's from Connecticut or Albany, but he's described as being from both. And there's this incredible scene where he's in a whale boat, and they're chasing a whale, and the whale hits the ship, and he falls into the ocean. And this just makes me think about it, because I'm trying to maybe work around to what you're getting at. And he's saved. He's pulled out of the ocean, I can't remember, by Stubb or by Flask, by one of the officers of the... And he said, you have to be careful because, you know, we just lost that whale because of you, and we're not, and that the oil in that whale's body is worth more than you are in an Alabama market, so be careful. So, of course, you know, a second later, he's back in the ocean. He falls back in the ocean, and he's left to drift. And it's this remarkable passage where Melville has him drifting in the ocean, and his ebon head is, you know, bobbing like a clove, and it's unclear whether he actually goes under the sea into the water, or if he just fears it. But he grasps the totality. He sees God's foot on the loom. He imagines the beginning of time, and it's this remarkable moment where Pip sees the complete compression of time and space. And he comes out, and he finally is rescued, and he's put back on the ship, and he comes out a little bit mad. He never really recovers. And Melville gives that vision to other people on the ship, Ishmael and others, but they all don't quite grasp the significance. It's only Pip that grasps the significance about the meaninglessness of the universe and the emptiness of the cosmos. And it's fairly clear that Melville gets that paragraph, that vision that he attributes to Pip, from Darwin. Darwin travels across the Andes, And as and it's recounted in the book on in the voyage of the Beagle, you know, his journeys, his journals, and he talks about how he's crossing the Andes and he looks east and he looks across the Pampas, and it's one of it's the most exhilarating moment in Darwin's narrative, where he glimpses the beginning of time. He sees the Atlantic lapping at the base of the Andes. He sees he sees the world as nothing but water, and it's a formative moment in Darwin's thinking about geology and geological time. And it's fairly and Melvillians know that Melville read Darwin, and it's fairly clear, nobody's really made this, but this is my reading of it, that Melville takes that paragraph and assigns it to Pip, this little black cabin boy. What's fascinating about it, and this goes back to the other question about the pervasiveness of slavery, is Darwin has that vision on exactly the same slave road that Bob O'Mori and the others were forced to climb over. So it's that intertextuality that what does one make of that? So Darwin has this vision that becomes the foundation of Darwin's understanding of geologic time on a slave road over the Andes. He describes that in that paragraph is then taken by Melville and given to Pip, the little black cabin boy, and it's on the same slave road that Bob O'Mori and others were forced marched over 20 something years before. So this, I don't think I answered your question about the centrality of the sea, but it was I was just thinking about the enormity of Pip seeing the sea as a metaphor for the emptiness of the universe. And this, I guess this kind of does circle around to what you're saying, what you're asking is the sea as a metaphor. And again, if those Melvillians who want to say that all of Melville's grappling with these questions of meaning and emptiness and nothingness and the insignificance of the individual in the face of this larger whatever, that has nothing to do with slavery. It seems to be obviously about slavery. Hundreds and hundreds of years of bringing millions and millions of people over, that all of those metaphysical concerns of the individual and meaning in the face of, slavery was the concrete manifestation of that. And so I guess the sea as a metaphor for that emptiness certainly is related to slavery, right? The individual lost in the sea and what that means and what slavery and the enslavement of individuals in this larger sea.
Thank you for such a rich lecture and so many things. One thing that piqued my imagination is you mentioned the seal extraction and the as the first organized effort to extract beyond the borders of and into international regions and leading to an ecological crisis, to the disappearance of these seals in various regions. And you presented this in the context of also the institution of slavery and the control and domination of a people and the conjunction of these two. I just wonder if you would like to elaborate a little bit on this issue of extraction and ecological degradation that comes into the picture. I think fascinating. Thank you.
Oh, elaborate a little bit more on extraction. Well, I mean, it forms a big part of the book, the sealing trade, and it also allows for an almost ethnographic window onto the experience of freedom and slavery, because the experience of sealers on board these islands and their relationship to the ship crew, ship officers, and the ship, it was something less obviously than freedom. I don't elaborate more on just extraction in general, or Well, I was just trying to make the point that I just thought that the taking Amasa Delano as prototype of this extractor that was very much involved during this first experience of resource extraction in the South Pacific, and trying to understand how it intersects with it allowed for a bringing together of these two different ways of two different studies or two different race violence, but also the moment in which race is forged in some ways, right? It is in the violent putting down of this rebel ship that he's able to establish his authority over his largely white crew of escaped Botany Bay convicts, escaped from not Botany Bay, from Hobart. It's the moment in race is formed and forged in terror, and I just thought it nicely brings those two things together. I'm not sure if I have anything more to say other than extraction. The importance of sealing and how it represents a certain kind of a much more bloody form of extraction than in some ways that even whaling does, and embodies almost settler colonialism. These sealers established something like the United States' first informal colonies in the South Pacific. I mean, during the flush years, when things were going well and they were making a lot of money, there was actually a lot of cooperation. These sea captains ruled different islands as if they were, they set up these ad hoc councils of governing councils in which they administered debt, they assigned script, they ruled over different disputes. There was a lot of actual cooperation among sealers when there were a lot of seals to kill, and you see in very vivid terms the way that cooperation immediately gives way to rivalry and confrontation, to pitched battles over territory as it becomes a very, I think, strong metaphor, a strong analogy for other forms of resource extraction and as it relates to imperial power.
Fascinating and rich, Greg. This last comment picks up something I wanted to raise, at least one half of it. You could say, given what you just described, that you could have played with this theme of American Revolution and its paradox, not in terms of the empire of necessity only, but in terms of the necessity of empire. Because here, after all, is an American captain in far, far from the territorial boundaries of the United States, imposing rule in the name of property, in the name of returning property to its proper owner.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And doing so because he himself is driven by credit and debt and competition to get a piece of the action, at least in part.
Yeah.
So that's one of the things that occurred to me. But also, what I've been thinking, although I haven't read the novel nor your book yet, is I wonder whether you're looking back too much to the paradox of freedom and slavery coming together in the first 50 years after the American Revolution, first 60, 70 years after the American Revolution, rather than thinking about 1855 and looking forward, could it be that Melville is looking to what will emancipation really mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Is it not a mirage? And will necessity not lead to wage slavery?
Yeah, yeah.
But
yeah,
you've hardly talked
yeah,
about
yeah.
that.
I think absolutely. I mean, I think he's looking forward, and that's what I was alluding to. I think that's what makes the novel, what makes Benito Sereno so powerful still. I mean, I think there is a sense that there's this.
I don't mean it in terms of race. I mean in terms of wage slavery.
Right.
In the typical American leftist way, you're focused on race, if I may.
Right.
And not at all.
Well, I think there is some, yes, it is true. I think there is, you can only focus on you can only focus on certain things at a certain time, but it is true that I think there is some explaining to do about the endurance of why race continues to be so intractable. And not just in a general way. I mean, we've seen, I'm not carrying any water for Barack Obama, but you see the you see the reaction and the rhetoric is just so. I mean, like the force of the politics can't be discussed without reference to the Civil War and what is that about and why is it so and why is it so intractable, but I think that certainly it could be extended to wage labor and some of Melville's greatest writings, some of his short stories get at wage labor and of course the refusal of wage labor. Bartleby Scrivener is the perfect example, but other short stories as well, but and certainly the necessity of empire, obviously. Yeah, I mean, you know, there's a way in which that runs throughout the book, the way the belief that the move west is going to solve the problem of slavery, but it does not solve the problem of slavery, but it obviously extends empire. And thinking about empire as the frontiers of this kind of resource extraction and how it relates to race violence. But there was something else that I wanted to say. Oh, there's also something else that runs out through the book. So in the talk, I kind of opposed Ahab to Amasa Delano as these two prototypes, saying Amasa Delano would be a more useful way of thinking about the mechanics and laws of extraction and empire. But obviously they're related in all sorts of ways. I mean, I think there's ways in which the move from a more self-conscious and violent and wild form of empire represented by Ahab to a more bland form, an administrative bureaucratic form represented by Amasa Delano, there's more of a dialectical relationship between those two, and it gets to your first comment, the necessity of empire.
Thank you. That was amazing. What an amazing story. And I wondered about the enslaved and then free and then enslaved again people who are at the center of the story, and how much in the documents you've got you can say anything at all about their subjectivity or the way that the story might have looked from their point of view. In particular, I wondered whether the sort of, what looks to me from a very cursory leafing through your book here, it looks to me like there were a series of legal processes that were going on, that went on after they were recaptured, and did they have any voice at all? Do you have any of their words, or do you have anything except their actions to tell us about their agency?
No, and it's an interesting question. I mean, it obviously raises a lot of methodological questions about. It's all through. There's nothing. In fact, there's tantalizing hints. They were, when they were imprisoned in Concepcion, in Talcahuano and in Concepcion, and they sent a confessor in, it was funny because I found a reference in a catalog that said that that there was a document in Madrid that included the testimony taken, but it wasn't the, but it was just summarized in a very cursory way. Extremely cursory way, so that didn't exist. And no, and Melville confronts this. I think that's one of the, Melville includes all of those documents in Benito Cedeño. It is an experiment in form, not just in the sense that that story is told through the point of view of Amasa Delano. It's structured where the first third of the book or two thirds of the book is through Amasa Delano, and then readers are told about what actually happened through Melville. So Amasa, in the historical Amasa Delano's memoir, he includes all of these Spanish documents because he's making his case about how badly he was treated by the Spaniards. So he includes all of those documents in his memoir. Melville just transcribes them and puts them in the story, and he makes small changes in it. So in some ways, it is a kind of one could do a reading of how Melville is highlighting the impossibility of getting at subjectivity that the only way that subjectivity is revealed is through these, the discursive apparatus of the Spanish Empire. But
it's both amazing that those documents were in circulation so early that that they could have come through Delano to Melville, and also heartbreaking that you can't. Oh God, a confession would have been amazing.
Yeah.
History sucks.
Is there one more question before we end? Okay, Patrick.
Thank you for a very, very thoughtful lecture, and I've been it's been percolating through my mind, and I have been flipping through the book too. You referred to Hegel, and I looked up that passage on the phenomenology, and just what would happen if you were to call this, instead of the empire of necessity, the necessity of freedom? Or why would you not look at that problematic, the necessity of freedom? Because in a sense, that's the other side of the story that's so powerful here. So I'm just curious about that sort of flip.
The necessity of freedom?
The necessity of freedom.
To me, that resonates a little bit too closely to the kind of ideal of freedom that Melville would be critiquing, or the idea that there is, the empire of necessity sounds very Hegelian to me. It sounds very, very Germanic. Why didn't I call it the necessity of freedom? I guess I didn't think of it.
Is there a structural bias really in what we're doing that suggests really that we shouldn't be struggling for freedom? That struggle, in fact, was didn't really go anywhere, and that so the white freedom, which is constructed on blackness, that you come back to so often, in fact, becomes the dominant freedom, and what we lose then is in fact the ongoing struggle for freedom, which I guess is picked up in the class struggle as well. That's you see what again? It's sort of a question of emphasis and how one structures the argument.
Yeah. I think that the weight of the story doesn't lend itself to that. I mean, I think it lends itself to a much more. It lends itself to a more pessimistic read. I think I don't think it lends itself to the idea. I think part of the problem is the idea. Dear of freedom is. I'm not sure. I have to think more about it. But I was never. I'm not big on the freedom. On the freedom as an ideal, to aspire to, in the way that that word is used.
In the context of white individual versus the slave society, that's a problematic notion of freedom. But if you have a different concept of freedom,
right.
Which I would argue Hegel actually is suggesting, then
right.
You might come up with a different
synthesis.
Yeah. Okay. I'll think.
Oh no! Thank you. No, I was thinking that your intervention would be more powerful if it were formulated as the Empire of Freedom.
Well, there's a lot of books. There's a lot of books about the Empire of Liberty, Empire of Freedom. I wanted to call the book Who Ain't a Slave. The marketing people wouldn't let me because this was before 12 Years a Slave. They said that it wouldn't sell.
I side with your position, but I think that his criticism would have been more powerful had it been formulated that way.
I'm sorry. I'm now I'm completely lost.
It's late.
I think we're done here. Thank you all. There's surely much more to say.
Thank you so much, everyone, for coming out. I know it's York, 8 o'clock at night. It's late, and we're delighted that you're still here. And thank you so much, Greg, for coming.
Thanks.
And have a safe trip home, everybody. And we'll see you later.